YMCI, Youth and Community Development Services Providers.
Lights, camera, action.
Morale Builders Inc. proudly presents the MBI TV Showcase.
This is another Morale Builders Inc. TV Showcase coming to you.
The Swift Mansion was built in and around 1892. Its first owners were members of the famous meatpacking industry heirs, Mr. and Mrs. Edward Morris. Miss Morris was the daughter of the late multimillionaire five times over again in Chicagoan Gustavus F. Swift, founder of the Swift Company, who lived here in Chicago's near Southside, who died and left a Swift family estate valued at $40 million. Mr. Edward Morris, also son of the meatpacking giant Nelson Morris, one of the three leading meatpackers in the world, along with Gustavus F. Swift Sr. At the time of their wedding, Edward was the president and treasurer of his father's meatpacking dynasty, also residents of Chicago's near North Side. This marriage between Edward Morris and Helen Swift was typically the cultural tradition of times in Chicago's upper class. When you've seen it in Chicago's local newspaper, many social parties, mainly among the rich and affluent, from 1890 to 1920. The Swift Mansion is built with its massive stone gray granite exterior, classic-like motifs, and reminiscent of the H&H Richardson architectural style built during the final decade of the 19th century. This was one of the celebrated architects when the Swift Mansion was built, right leading up to the National Columbian Exposition, when the South Side of Chicago was experiencing rapid growth and expansion in economic, social, and real estate architectural development. This architectural and aesthetic value for the Swift was important to keep the property within the family. For instance, the property fell to the father of the late Augustus F. Swift Sr., founder of the Swift Company, who gave the property to his son Herbert L. Swift, and Herbert lived there after his marriage to Miss Bernice Jocelyn in 1901. The family heirloom became the residence to this couple. The national historical significance and the impact of the Swift's packing industry upon the United States are three important national areas: Industrial Revolution, antitrust laws, and African-American migration. Their packing industry business is very relevant in impacting massive migration of African-Americans from farms in the South to urban communities in Chicago and other Midwestern cities, to name only a few: Omaha, Nebraska, Kansas City, Missouri, St. Louis, Missouri, Chicago, Illinois. That Swift located his meatpacking slaughterhouses that were able to create work for African-American farmers that came up from the South. The one important thing that the Swift industry did is the packing industry owners, they owned the majority of them, of these packing industry owners lived in Chicago, and was just one of those industries there, one of the big industries that started the Industrial Revolution in America. The automobile industry, the railroad industry, the meatpacking industry. This impacted the farming and agricultural industry that drove the economy of the future for the Industrial Revolution age. Swift built stockyards, stock exchanges, and packing and slaughterhouses that engaged the massive migration wave from the South of African Americans seeking for a better life in urban communities throughout America. The African Americans went through the first and second wave of the United States migration, and the packing house industry was one of the many Chicago industrial strengths, and that could provide better paying wages, earning jobs than farmers receiving your wages and annually from agricultural means. The Swift Mansion's history, now the Chicago Packers Millionaires Dynasty, created the economic infrastructure combining almost $533 million worth of value to the economy of America in the Chicago near South Side. The immigration of African Americans exiting from the South, they had a better opportunity in the cities, and this created the first, second, and third waves of African Americans coming to Chicago in most Midwestern cities. Chicago also was an influence on the government of the United States through the packing industry by several lawsuits through the packers from 1892, 1899, 1911, 1919. Chicago packers had to deal with the violating of antitrust laws that allegedly established them as an industrial monopoly. This legal action by the United States Attorney General Palmer's office were two landmark cases, December 29, 1911, December 19, 1919, resulted in a national concern for the Chicago Packers called the Triumvirate, and then later they were called the Big Three, which included the lawsuit where Augustus F. Swift was mentioned, J. Ogden Armour, and Edward Morris, the one that married Augustus' daughter. The majority of the meetings were held in secret at Augustus F. Swift's home, end up involving governmental intervention. The deal that they struck in the South Side community of Chicago was valued at $923 million. The United States government established through court an injunction that it violated the federal Sherman Antitrust Act, which limited the Chicago Packers' production of meat, poultry, bread, eggs, cheese, condensed milk, by limiting the railroad refrigerator cars' monopoly until the Supreme Court was able to have a hearing. The transition of ownership of the Swift Mansion that brought it into African-American hands in and around 1930 by one of the viable African-American urban business industries, the funeral home business, known by the company of McGavitt and Sons Funeral Home. This certain group of people purchased the Swift Mansion, as was known in the Chicago Millionaire's Row, for suburban whites from 1860s to 1930s, when African Americans began to populate this area of Chicago. This was an era where African Americans in Chicago began to control the historical architectural wealth of the urban core, as many African American religions began to purchase property for houses of worship in the surrounding communities of Chicago's once prominent Millionaire's Row area of the city. By individuals acquiring, maintaining, and preserving Chicago's historically significant architectural pearls that embodied the history of Chicago's founding fathers' cultural lifestyles that developed out of the two great national events that were held here in Chicago's near South Side, the Columbian Exposition and the Chicago World's Fair. When whites began to move further away from the city, these churches and business owners, by purchasing these properties, the white suburbans allow what you call urban sprawl or white flight, caused white Chicagoans to abandon their forefathers' rich architectural and historical wealth that embodied the story of Chicago's early development from the 1830s to the 1930s. One of the major purchases made, the Swift Mansion, was the start of the local National Urban League here in America. Its inception started in Chicago at the Chicago Mansion at 4500 Michigan Avenue. The Urban League got its start in Chicago at the Swift Mansion by making the purchase. And the Urban League began to work with many African Americans that came up from southern cities to help them to integrate within these northern cities. In the early 40s, several important African American religious leaders developed their genesis within Chicago's South Side Millionaire Row vicinity. The First Church of Deliverance, Reverend Charles Combs, and Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, St. Paul Church of God in Christ, and later both located one block from each other, one block away from the Swift Mansion. They will become a major influence in the religious, social, political landscape of African Americans in Chicago's near South Side. Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, pastor of St. Paul Church of God in Christ, established his church in 1934 on 45th and Wabash, a block from the Swift Mansion in the vicinity of Chicago's South Side, known as Millionaire's Row. Bishop Ford, one of Chicago's African-American pioneering personalities in 1941, purchased Chicago's oldest house, the Widow Clark House, located right behind the historic Swift Mansion, located on 45th and Michigan Avenue. Bishop Lewis Henry Ford accomplished something that would define his legacy as an African-American minister. He became known as one of the great heroes of preserving Chicago's historical heritage. For more than 35 years, he restored and maintained the Widow Clark House. As an African-American, he, as an African-American pioneering clergy, had the foresight to preserve the architectural legacy of Chicago in the early 40s on Chicago's near South Side. Bishop Lewis Henry Ford of the Church of God in Christ, like his mentor, Bishop Charles Harrison Mason, founder of the Church of God in Christ in 1895, today is one of the largest African-American Pentecostal organizations in America. Bishop Ford was trained as his national public relations director to always involve the white political figures of your city to keep interactive relationships with City Hall. Bishop Ford kept with this early tradition of Bishop Charles Harrison Mason, who would, at his national meetings in Memphis, Tennessee in the 30s and 40s, have Bishop Mason as his national public relations director invite mayors, senators, governors to Bishop Mason's to his civic night services. This would always be dedicated to highlight political figures long before most African-American religious groups interacted with segregated whites in political arenas. Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, mentored by Bishop Charles Harrison Mason, who had appointed him as bishop in Chicago's near North Side in the 50s. Bishop Charles Harrison Mason established this trend within his national organization by interacting with political governments long before African-American denominational leaders did. For example, in 1917, Bishop Charles Harrison Mason wrote President Woodrow Wilson a telegram requesting an audience with him surrounding African-American organizations' position concerning World War I, being a conscientious objector. This resulted in him having a meeting at the White House with President Wilson's with his staff of the Selective Service. When he had the meeting with the Selective Service, Wilson's cabinet agreed, according to his Christian faith, that he would not have to bear arms. Mason developed a document that he shared with the members of his African American movement that when they went before them to present the conscientious objector position, they had an official document from the organization stating that they would not have to enlist in World War I. This early exposure of Bishop Mason's dialoguing with high officials caused him to be investigated by the FBI for his position as being an African American that believed in the 14th Amendment of the Constitution of the United States. Later in 1918, despite President Wilson's support of Bishop Mason's Christian position to not take up arms, according to his Christian faith, the American Jim Crow mentality of the South could not take an African-American Church of God in Christ, African-American presenting a letter to their parole or their, not their parole, but to their actual sites where they would not have to enlist in World War I. Because of this, Mason's name became spread abroad nationally. And by this reason, the FBI began to investigate Bishop Charles Harrison Mason and tried to try him for treason against the United States. He also, even though he had gotten permission from President Woodrow Wilson, the FBI still proceeded with their court case. The position of the military later on today involves the historical case of Mason versus the United States government in 1918 to 1919, with the investigation of the FBI and the actual court case taking place in Paris, Texas in 1919. But Mason actually, with his attorneys, won the case against the United States government. The heart of African American protest for civil rights stated within the African American religious movement this happened long before Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s civil rights movement. By this established trend within Bishop Mason having a more direct approach to government officials, rather than having fear of most African-American leaders, instead of him fearing their retaliation, he decided to dialogue directly with governmental officials. This trend was established with Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, the Chicagoan here. He established a very good relationship with Mayor Richard J. Daley, and many other governmental officials. Bishop Ford's job was to bring together political and religious leaders and allow them to have a voice to be able to share with his clientele. Bishop Ford, as early as the 50s, would have Mayor Richard J. Daley kick off his conferences surrounding the Church of God in Christ and their churches. He was located at 45th and Wabash at the historical St. Paul Church of God in Christ. In 1955, Bishop Lewis Henry Ford preached the eulogy of Emmett Till, who became known historically as the sacrificial lamb of the civil rights movement in America. The parents of Emmett Till were members of Ford's Southside Chicago Church at St. Paul Church of God in Christ. The death of Emmett Till moved the nation of America to begin to protest senseless lynching of African-American males for years. And this teenager that was murdered and mutilated while visiting his grandmother in Money, Mississippi, when his mother sent him from the Chicago South Side to be there for the summer. Bishop Ford also sold the Clark House, later on the oldest house in Chicago, to Mayor Richard J. Daley, so that Chicago would own one of its oldest houses still in existence, because Bishop Ford had the foresight as a preservationist to preserve the history of Chicago's founding fathers long before they established the Illinois State Historical Association and the city's historical preservation commissions, which were organized in the 60s to rethink for them to be able to take back within the urban core the historically preserved architectural history of Chicago. Bishop Ford, known for establishing relationships with political machinery of Chicago, early on directed He developed a close friendship with Mayor Richard J. Daley and became close friends with his family to the degree that at his funeral, he actually escorted his wife. Bishop Ford, a great political figure in Chicago and America, knew most presidents from Truman all the way to Clinton, who he invited Clinton to his national conference in 1994 when he became elevated to National Presiding Bishop of the Pentecostal African American Religious Group while residing in Chicago. President Clinton attended Bishop Ford's invitation, the first president of the United States to be invited to an African American religious denomination service. He came because Dr. Martin Luther King spoke at Ford's organization's world headquarters the day before he was assassinated in 1968. It was at Bishop Ford's National Organization's World Headquarters, the historic Mason Temple. In the 40s, this building was one of the largest facilities that Mason had built that African Americans had actually built from the ground up. Dr. Martin Luther King utilized this building many times for his rallies in the Memphis, Tennessee area. And it just so happens the day before he was assassinated that he actually had used Mason, the historic Mason Temple, the world headquarters of the Church of God in Christ, for his final rally. His last speech to the world was, "I've been to the mountaintop," but this particular facility is where he actually gave his last speech to the world. The son of Mayor Richard Daley held a celebration for Ford as a Chicagoan who had represented the city well by becoming elevated to this prestigious office. Ford was always a very political individual as a minister and was a trendsetter. In addition to this, Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, a highway after his death was dedicated to Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, the Bishop Lewis Henry Ford Expressway here in Chicago. As was stated early in the development of protests and support of the African American religious experience within our culture, you will see that there is a strengthening of it within the embodiment of the African American church. In 1786, 200 years before Rosa Parks' protests, Richard Allen and Absalom Jones refused to be treated differently than their white counterparts as Methodists in a Philadelphia service. They decided to form the first African American church solely operated by African Americans. The end result was that they ended up forming the first African Methodist Episcopal Church in America, and they ended up having to go to court in order to have the right to oversee their finances of their worship services. The start of this particular thing is what gives individuals the right to worship African-American churches all throughout the city of Chicago and throughout America because of Richard Allen's court case, Allen versus the United States. One of the things that Allen did that was very, very important to African-Americans in the 1700s, he started welfare in the African-American community. By in 1889, Richard Allen, he paid for his freedom, and then he established the Free African Society. This developed a fund to take care of widows, the homeless, the sick African Americans. There was no hospitals or welfare systems near for the earlier generations of African Americans. They leaned on their religious institution for support in social and human service needs. In the early slavery era, an individual named Sojourner Truth, an African-American Methodist, she was a lay individual that was able to lead from the South many slaves to the North through the Underground Railroad. Many white Christians assisted African-Americans in running away from their slave masters because they didn't believe that slavery was a part of their Christian faith. Many Quakers and Methodist white congregations and individuals assisted African-Americans by allowing them to secure a place with them while white Southerners tried to track them down to return them back to their slave masters in the southern states of the United States. The early plight of the older African American was that the church or religious institution, because of racism in America, they had to look to their churches for philanthropic needs. The church started the beginning of collectivism and groupism that calls encouraging earlier African Americans to work together to help each other to make it. The larger society left African Americans broke in poverty, helpless, and those people needed the resources of the church. Also, Allen started the first African American news publication in America, and he established the African American social consciousness of a more perfect union philosophy. This particular philosophy affected a black man called Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass was able to dialogue and debate with President Abraham Lincoln, and he became one of his ambassadors and right-hand men that was able, because of Allen's philosophy of a theological liberation approach. With this theological liberation approach, Frederick Douglass was able to dialogue with President Lincoln about including African Americans in the cavalry, and he established the first influx of African Americans fighting in the war. With President Abraham Lincoln being an Illinoisan, this also goes back to the history of Illinois. The great history that we embody here in this South Side area of Chicago, where the Swift Mansion is, its history is far-reaching beyond national and regional borders in the history of the United States. For this reason, the current owners, Mr. And Mrs. Maurice Perkins, they partnership with us, the National Museum of African American Religions. We're partnering with them in order to establish a
archiving and preserving our history electronically, you've logged on to the National Museum of African American Religions.
Thank you for visiting us today. I'm Reverend Elijah Hill, President and CEO of the National Museum of African American Religion. We're a 501c3 IRS tax-exempt organization to benefit you when you give your gifts during the tax season. Our vision since 1998 is to ensure the identification and collaboration of all African American religious history to be displayed and included in the future project of the National Museum of History in Washington, D.C. as a vital part of African Americans' history. Our goal is to ensure that archiving, preserving, and funding of our history electronically be a part of the Smithsonian's vision by partnering with other advocates within our community. We have selected the city of Chicago, Illinois, as the home of our museum to identify the important contribution of African American religious history in the United States of America. The United States Senate and Congress in 2003 approved the bill to build a museum to represent the contribution of African Americans in America's history. American religion has been the flagship of our inspiration and encouragement when the test of disenfranchisement said we couldn't make it. It became our strength down through the annal of time and our cultural stability and legacy, reflecting the breadth and unexplainable depth of those of African descent who died and have gone on before us from the time of slavery unto this present day. She, religion, was the cradle of our confidence, and she gave birth as the midwife in the secret places of slums and ghettos to some of our greatest and brightest African American leaders, and was the foundation of some of our greatest athletes, musical and entertainment talent in the world. We thank you for visiting us today. And you can visit our website and tour. If you click on denominations, you'll be able to see all of the major faiths that have been started by African Americans in America. Our clergy awards will be hosted in Chicago, Illinois. If you click on clergy awards and you click on the flyer, you'll be able to go to the poll to nominate a pastor or clergy leader. And we look forward to seeing you at our clergy awards in 2010. God bless you.
Welcome to the national polling site for the 2010 National Clergy Awards. To vote for your pastor or any religious clergy, click on the link that says web-based voting poll via the web.
His sister's patience long, but soon it won't happen. To find a job is like a haystack needle, cause where it lives.
Welcome to a special edition of The Real Deal. My name is Boaz Edwards, your host. The Inner City Youth Foundation is the organization designed to save the children. Here with me for this segment is Mr. Maurice Perkins, brother Maurice Perkins, the director and founder of the Inner City Youth Foundation, Inc. Welcome to The Real Deal, my brother.
Thank you, Boise, for having me.
Listen, Maurice Perkins has worked over 20 years in the city in civil service, blue-collar community, as they call it now, the blue-collar community. As a matter of fact, he worked for the Chicago Fire Department 5 years, 2 years with the Chicago Police Department, 7 years with the Water Reclamation District, 3 years with the Chicago Department of Human Services, 3 years as a longshoreman at Navy Pier, and 3 years with the with his Uncle Sam, the U.S. Army.
Amen.
You did all of that.
Yes, I did.
Listen, tell our viewers, what is the mission of Inner City Youth Foundation, for those at home who don't know?
The mission of Inner City Youth Foundation is to upgrade the quality of life in the inner city communities that we serve.
I see. And now, where are you located?
We're located at 4500 South Michigan Avenue in Chicago.
Now, how long has the foundation been existing?
We were founded in 1974. We had a nightclub called Caesar's Palace at 45th and Cottage Grove, and we have been quite successful. And some of the police and fire department friends I had wanted to do something socially in the community, like hold softball tournaments and take the young people out of the community.
Now, what are some of the programs or some of the services that the foundation offers to young people?
Well, right now, today we're working with new citizens. That means those people that are returning from incarceration that need support in many ways in terms of life management skills. You talk about job development, securing identification. As you know, a lot of people leave prison and incarceration without any ID. And we're also working on a transitional housing program at the mansion as well.
Now, you know, I like that term, new citizens.
That's correct.
Because they are new citizens, because whatever they've done, they paid their debt to society, and they're coming on anew, like a new birth.
Well, I'm actually plagiarizing a dear friend of mine by the name of Chris Moore.
Yes, sir.
And Chris Moore runs Exodus Renewal Society. He worked with the Urban League for several years, and he's about 20 years my junior, and hopefully he'll be taking over for me shortly, because he coined the phrase new citizen.
Well, you know, as my great-grandfather always told me, there's nothing new under the sun, but you didn't plagiarize because you let everybody know who said it.
Well, I'm just so proud of it, because he was a young man that did some time out in Los Angeles, mm-hmm. and was involved in some very strange criminal things out there, and he's come to Chicago, and he's gotten himself a BA degree in sociology, and he's writing legislation and all to help those that were incarcerated mm-hmm. to have human rights, at least upon return.
Brother Perkins, there's something happening, something that's taking place at your facility at the Michigan Street location. What is the good news?
Well, the good news is that my state representative, Kenneth Ken Duncan, who chairs tourism, has seen fit to give us a pretty large grant to do the restoration of the Swift Mansion. The Swift Mansion was built in 1892 by Gustavus Swift. He was one of the richest people in Chicago at the time. He built this building for his daughter Catherine, who lived in the building and also married the second largest meat packer in the country at that time, Mr. Morrison, and they lived in the building. The building has to be the finest a building in Chicago. It's made out of a Georgia marble, and a lot of people mistake that for limestone. And it has hand-carved oak throughout, and it has some wood even more expensive than oak, which is birch, and it adorns the mantles and things like that in the building. And, you know, we worked for 10 years trying to secure funds, and just thank God for Representative Ken Duncan, who brings a new wave leadership to mm-hmm. the community and is aggressively securing funds for people in Bronzeville at this time where we have not been able to secure funds.
Let me ask a question now. Bronzeville, and then you've been involved in that, as a resume, say, for over 20,
50 years in Brownsville.
Right. Now, but it appears that those people who have been in Brownsville, when it was not Brownsville, or when it was just King Drive or whatever it was, it appears that those people are being moved out. I mean, what is the issue here?
Well,
I mean, Brownsville is a big deal now.
Right.
But what is the issue now? Are those folks who was there when it was nothing, 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 nothing?
Well, those people have been displaced, and Brownsville has become a very bullish market. And in fact, we've got Wall Street capital on the streets of Brownsville making purchases of properties. And in fact, like we talked about, my taxes going from $8,000 to $38,000, which is a fact. We're being displaced, and older residents like myself, we're expecting the city council, the general assembly, or somebody to grandfather us in so we don't get caught in this Wall Street gold rush, because, you know, they're not playing the market no more. They're playing the bricks and mortar in Brownsville, and they're really displacing a lot of people. As you go through South Shore and other people, you see people from public housing living out there and trying to maintain with very little training, very little support. Nobody's really helping them. They just were pushed out of CHA. I'm a part of the Hope 6 application that got the $1 billion in transformation funds. And, you know, they're really not bringing people in to deal with WASH and contract compliance and job development and things like that. But the Hope 6 application that they submitted to HUD that got them this $1 billion of transformation money said that they would be adhering to some rules, which they have not.
Well, let me ask this question, and then we'll get on to some other stuff for the time is running out. I mean, you understand that. Other people in that community understand that. Why aren't some, the so-called, I hate to say leadership, or those who live, how come they're not following up? You know about the Hope 6 piece, how they playing with the money and what have you.
Well, all roads in this town lead to the fifth floor now. If it's not sanctioned by the fifth floor, it's not going to happen. Our aldermen and people down there of color are just ornamentation to a person that is going to run this with an iron fist, and he's going to do what he sees fit, and he is uplifting the Hispanic community, basically, and he has no need for blacks to apply.
Let me ask you another question now. Back to the Swiss Mansion. Are there some other organizations or groups or individuals that's involved in this rehab project?
Well, you know, we got some of our Hispanic brothers out of there. I got my iron worker is a German guy from the north side that rides bikes, and he's all tattooed, and a lot of the brothers are looking at him. But we set out to be a multiracial company, and we've been certified by IDOT, and our chief estimator and engineer in the company, he's white. And, you know, we're not trying to segregate against anyone. We're trying to bring in the best people so we can be effective. And Community Bank over in Bridgeport, they extended us a line of credit to match the funds that we had gotten from State Representative Ken Duncan. And we're really doing things. And I try to temper the things I say based on, I get a lot of cooperation from the Caucasian community and other communities.
Sure, you know. Sure. I mean, the whole issue is to get the job done.
Absolutely.
I mean, when you limited yourself to just a certain particular area, I mean, there's expertise, but I just always say, let's be fair with it. If it's nine jobs, we spread out nine jobs, nine different places. Let me ask this question. Now, what are some of the pressing issues that you see that's concerning the foundation or in that community?
Well, our young people, they basically have very little assistance in terms of workforce development, or the mayor's programs. They're virtually non-existent in the community. And as we go to City Hall to do things, we find ourselves always paying. We're paying for this, we're paying for that. But we don't receive the services and the help for our young people in the community from City Hall. So I'm just about to say, you know, thank God for the General Assembly and our representative Ken Duncan, who is a young man out of Cabrini Green, and in the Marion Stamps tradition, is saying that he's going to deliver resources regardless to what City Hall says.
Matt, this question. Now, what can folk who are watching this show, folk at home, do to, in fact, how can they become involved in inner city youth and what you're doing? Because I see you have a lot of young people doing trades work you know, they're fixing up and what have you, they're doing drywall and what have you. What can folk at home who want to help young people, what can they do to assist Brother Perkins?
Well, they can donate to Inner City Youth Foundation and our restoration project, because we're working on one of the most historical buildings in Chicago. Swift Packing Company is the reason that black people came to Chicago in the first place. We were sharecroppers in Mississippi. Our first hourly wage came from the stockyards of Chicago that ran from 31st to 51st Street on Halsted. This town was once known as the Promised Land based on the economics that took place for us. The Defender will bear witness in their articles that this was known as the Promised Land before the dictators and the small-time Napoleonic complex people took over. Mm-hmm. See, everybody down there is for self now. You know, this used to be known as the Promised Land based on Swift armor. You could work 8 hours at Swift.
And all
you
of those was eight the meat hours at armor. Those were meatpacking companies.
Right, and
right?
These people were worldwide. They created four of the largest law firms that exist in Chicago now to take care of their worldwide interests. Swift had a black man that invented the refrigerated box car.
Right.
At the Columbian Exposition of the World's Fair, the White City over at the Museum of Science and Industry was financed by Swift, Rosenwald, and Armour.
So when did it go crazy?
Well,
but you know, now when you say this was the Promised Land,
this was the Promised Land.
Yeah, because if I was down there with Mr. Gilmore with that rope and them dogs, Jack, mm-hmm. anything would have been the Promised Land better than where I came from.
And then sharecropping was a situation where you worked all summer and you worked hard, and at the end of the season, Mr. Higginbottom would get the pen and say, "Well, Charlie, you know, you almost made it.
You almost made it, boy.
But you ate a little bit too many potatoes, yeah. and you know, your wife went and got that cabbage, and now you owe me." That's sharecropping. So the first hourly wage here in Chicago created an atmosphere of vitality, black businesses, people moving up. Swift was the economic engine for that.
Let me ask a question. We only got a couple more minutes left in the show. You mentioned about that you say the mayor and the people downtown, those aldermen. But whose fault is that?
Well,
because the community is not getting what they want. Whose fault is that?
See, Harry Washington asked me the same question. Why do we disengage? We disengage when the process is unfair. There are 11 city departments down there, tainted to the hilt, that if you don't have clout or you're not from HDO, you need not come to these different departments and even apply for a job. I mean, this thing is like blacks need not apply.
So how can we change it? My point is,
well,
we as the voters and the taxpayers, we put those people in office. We don't hold their feet to the fire.
I think the first thing we need to do is ask for Chairman Langdon Neal's resignation at the Board of Election Commissions. It was not the machine that created this fiasco this last time out. It was the urgency to put John Stroger back in and some other things. This was one of the worst elections I've ever seen. And Langdon Neal, being the son of Earl Neal, gets about $10 million annually in city money to do eminent domain, take your house, take your property. So I think it needs to start at the top, because there's no integrity in the system. If I give you $10 million a year, you mean you can't give me a few extra votes?
Yeah, I'm going to get choirs of church mouse walking on cotton ball. Let me ask you this question. Folks who want to become involved and they want to volunteer or come in and work with, who can they call? Where can they call? Give a number that can.
Well, they can call myself. I'm Maurice Perkins. I'm at the Inner City Youth Foundation, 4500 South Michigan. Our number is 773-624-0803. And we want you to come by and see these young men working. I mean, you talk about gangbanger this, gangbanger that. These young men are trying and they're working hard and they're moving this project forward for us, and we're so very proud of them, because, I mean, you know, 20 square feet of floor. I mean, we took up four levels of flooring in there. And just to see them work and sweat and do this, you know, you can put them down all you want, but they're bringing us up, and we appreciate that. And we want you to come and see this restoration project in motion.
Get that number again.
We're at 773 624 0803. We're working daily there at 4500 South Michigan Avenue. And thanks to Representative Ken Duncan, new wave leadership in the city, we really appreciate what he's done for us.
Now, if I stay on the west side of Chicago or the north side, you know, and my son, you know, he wants to become involved, can he become involved?
He can become involved. We've got several guys from the west side. We've got some black guys. The guys say, well, I know he used to be a king, but hell, he's not a king now. He's tuck point now. You know what I'm saying? So this is what we're interested in, that transformation. Why is it that black people are the only ones that can't redeem themselves,
right,
can't transition themselves? If the Hamburg Club could become the political auspices of City Hall.
The Hamburg Club, for those who don't know, what was the Hamburg Club?
Well, the Hamburg Club was the Bridgeport guys that...
The real Mayor Daley's gang.
The real gang there that started the 1919 riots, in fact.
That's right.
They were, you know, really instrumental, and that was between Bridgeport and Bronzeville.
Correct.
I've since tried to bridge the gap in Bridgeport and been a little bit successful, but I've taken my lumps as well.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Listen. You got 30 seconds. Look in that camera, tell those folks whatever you want to tell them so that we can get this thing, I mean, because we need to expand on this. And then
we keep looking at the Water Tower Place, which is a limestone, sandstone building. We want you to look at the Swift Mansion, which is a Georgia marble. We have gray stratification, blue stratification in this marble, and we're really the greatest building that this city has ever had. And we just really want people to come out and see this, because there's nothing in the city of Chicago in terms of an architectural structure that can compare to the Swift Mansion.
I want to take this time to thank my guest, Brother Maurice Perkins, the director and founder. Now, when did you find the inner city?
Well, you know, we found it in 1974. I was a big nightclub owner, living in Lake Point Towers. You know, I was having all this and that, and what happened was,
And at this time, I like to bring on my hero, my personal hero, my grassroots hero, my urban leadership hero, my new wave leadership hero of 27 years. A man that has worked in the community all his life. It brings tears to my eyes. Where this man has suffered, he has prayed, he's done everything. With a grassroots touch for 27 damn years. And he's still here. Excuse my expression. You know, a lot of us aren't here. I've seen him come and go in doing urban PR for 30 years. I've seen him come and go. I've seen the organizations come and go. But Maurice, you're still here. I love you. Okay. Definitely. He's still here. A lot of him's been bought out, a lot of him's sold out or whatever, but he's still here, down to the Swift Mansion. Keeping the cause on the low end in the hood alive for all of us. So this time I'd like to bring on my everyday hero, Maurice Perkins, and his first lady, Mrs. Christine Perkins.
Thank you so much, and we appreciate those words, Stormy. Mr. Jim Compton just walked in the room.
All right, Jim.
Jim, he doesn't talk to us very much. But he did make us the owner of a national and state historical landmark. So, by him not talking very much, he talks a great deal through his actions, and we deeply appreciate it because he handed us about $500,000 in equity. So we appreciate that. And thank you, Jim. Our Vice President, Floyd Davis, is going to introduce to you the Reverend Jesse Lewis Jackson. But we say to you that we are proud to have you in attendance. We deeply appreciate your support. We need it. The Inner City Youth Foundation serves the Robert Taylor Corridor, Ida B. Wells, the Inner City. We help put the gang troops together in the city of Chicago, and we are an organization where the rubber meets the road. We are not selected in who we serve. We serve everybody that opens the door in spite of what it may mean. We serve the people of the city of Chicago and the inner city community. And Reverend Jackson is a person, as I spoke to the South Suburban Ministers Conference last week, whether we like it or not, this is the greatest national black leader that has ever come on the scene. Now, we at the Inner City Youth Foundation, basically native Chicagoans, a lot of us from public housing like me, we are not about to let him retire without giving us the framework for progress. You know, whenever you begin to do something, you're going to be criticized. It's those that never do anything that are never criticized. So without further ado, I want to bring Brother Floyd Davis on, who I've known 30 years. When I spoke to the Reverend Jackson at the greatest project in the world, which was the LaSalle Street Project, we had bankers talking to us about financing our projects one-on-one, thanks to Reverend Jackson. I've been trying to get a title to my car from First Bank for 3 months. But as a result of the LaSalle Street Project, I got the title to my car the next day. Now, Mr. Diamond was not able to close on my $500,000 refinance project that same day, but I have hope alive based on the LaSalle Street Project. I mean, it was just really quite an experience. Do you know the black entrepreneurs across this country that can't get financing for their projects, that have good, solid ideas? And for Reverend Jackson to bring the money people in the room, that made sense to me. It made sense. It made sense. And all the corporate black leaders that are trying to pierce the corporate ceiling have an opportunity to do that based on the LaSalle Street Project. I want to give this man a warm round of applause for bringing the financing to the community that African Americans need to build their business. Reverend Jackson, thank you. Floyd, you'll come on and introduce the rest.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming out and supporting the Inner City Youth Foundation and helping us honor these pioneers in our community. And I'd like to first make a note that this award is called the Usaba Award because John Baptiste Point Usaba is a man that we feel at the Inner City Youth Foundation doesn't get enough recognition. John Baptiste Point Usaba was a man that founded the city in 1779 on the north bank of the Chicago River. So in the spirit of the pioneers, we want to honor some true pioneers tonight. He's talking about a man that never backed down from a fight, never fumbled, mumbled, always spoke with power, clarity, and authority. And tonight we honor him for being that pioneer and that great spirit of progress. We bring you, ladies and gentlemen, with great honor, the Reverend Jesse A. Jackson Jr.
Contracts and re-enfranchise ourselves and start distributing contracts. We fight each other over subcontracts and not the managerial contract. That's because we are giants, the grasshopper complexes. We got to break out. I appeal to you on this coming Saturday. Some amazing thing happened today. A new group has been formed called SEED. All these black contract groups, Omar Sharif and all the groups came together and form one round table. If there's more work than we can do, we're not getting our share because we're cutting each other up. And so if you got 8 basketballs and 5 ball players, why y'all fighting over ball? You got more balls than players. And so we decided to come together. We're gonna start getting our share of contract. That same sense of maturity, we're gonna take City Hall back. But we're gonna hit the county. And we're going to take the state. And so to me, that's what this is about. These children, when I knew Harold was going to win, after all the meetings we've been through with the Dorothy Tillman, Lou Palmer, all that, talking about these children, I was coming by 63rd College, and the bus turned, I guess, was going west. And the kids saw me in the car, they said, "Hey, Rev, what's happening? No time to be alive. October 5, no shit." "Hey, Rev, no time to be alive. October 5, no shit." When the October 5th Bullet Registration Drive, when the kids had embraced the culture of registration.
That's right.
And they were registering folk on IV in the hospital wards.
Right, yeah.
It was clear that we were going to win that campaign. We must make that thing happen again. And my last point, and I want y'all to get it, because so many people call and spend summer strings and jacket. "We're so glad you got out of jail, and we're glad you come home and all that." And somebody's on the radio, "Ripper, you said we should keep suffering, and I don't agree with you on that. We suffered enough." I think you missed the point.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Step in between suffering on somebody else's agenda. You go to work, you're overworked, underpaid, don't get promoted, don't have money for heat, get sick, can't buy medicine, suffer, cuss, complain, pray, go to work, overwork, underpaid, get sick, cuss, complain, go to church, do it again. You are suffering involuntarily. And as you suffer, somebody else rejoices. But when you change directions and suffer voluntarily for a higher goal, that's when you change things, when you suffer voluntarily to change things, and didn't suffer because you adjust to things. And that might seem a little deep philosophic, and let me tell you what that really means. Let me tell you what that means in street language. Rabbit hunting ain't no fun when the rabbit got the gun. And we got the gun. Love you very much. I hope to see y'all at the meeting on Saturday morning. We got to close ranks and start packing that place on Saturday. Not for my sake. We must close ranks for inner city youth, for our share of contracts, for Urban League. But to honor Harold's legacy means on Saturday morning, we got to, because we have a base from which we ran it. Am I right about that? And so I urge you, and I thank you so much for the support.
All right.
Okay. All right, now let's give it up for the Reverend Senior Reverend Jesse Jackson Sr. Toss it up. Absolutely. Yeah, that was beautiful. I mean, he definitely added some legacy to what this is all about. Is Janice here? Blanche? Now, Janice, who has been working with Inner City Youth for quite a while, she's been right there with Inner City Youth to try and bring this event together. We're going to have her introduce the lovely judge. Okay. But before we do that, Maurice Perkins just wants to read something special. This is a special message that he wants to provide for everybody. And then we're going to let Janice introduce the U.S. Northern District Judge. Maurice.